Where are your drums right now?
Yeah, exactly. I need my hair shot. Where was the, what was the first inkling of this story? I assume it was yours.
Yes, yeah. I was working in a restaurant in Austin, Texas, where I was living at the time, and I was at the cash register, and a young high school boy walked in his Letterman jacket and with all of his friends, and it immediately kind of sparked my interest, and I chose this non-illegal way of exploring that subject matter by having Lindsay explore it for me.
So it wasn't one of the
such a great way to put it.
Many news stories of this kind of thing happening at schools. It was really your libido that generated this whole thing.
My imagination, yeah. But I mean, it seemed like a good way to explore this idea through the teacher-student relationship.
And so, and there was no question in your mind at that point that you would write it up and have it directed and go to Sundance immediately?
So like, at the restaurant. In a way, that kind of like I did get that.
Feeling?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, you have that vibe of like, this is going to be good.
Yeah. So.
And so how hard was the process for you of going through those steps?
Surprisingly not that hard. I wrote it in about 4-5 months, and Lindsay helped a lot kind of craft her character to something that we thought really worked.
So a collaborative process.
Yeah,
it was very, yeah. I told her, I mean, from basically the week after I had the idea, I told her about the story that I wanted to do, and
did you immediately go out to high schools and start researching?
Or? I immediately started going out with high school boys just on the spot. No, I...
You were in high school at the time yourself.
Yeah.
Of course.
Exactly. I mean, we took our time a little bit with it. I think I did a couple films before we ended up finally shooting, and then we went out to Marfa, Texas, because we were shooting in Austin, Texas. We went out to Marfa and got into the character a lot, and then I started going to high schools and observing teachers and reading up about case studies of, mm-hmm. of teachers who had these sort of situations but had gotten away with it, and so they could be a bit more honest in their testimonials, although it was anonymous, you know. Mm-hmm. So I could get, like, we could get a little more into their heads, and that was
Is
really
there
useful.
A website or something? How do you find these?
There are websites, but
teachers who did it with their students.com or
something very similar to
sure
that,
it's
actually.
Like, yeah, type that in Google, yeah.
Yeah. No, there's a book.
There's a book that I had found that included case studies of these women.
And I was like, here, look at this. And I just read the whole thing, and it was really helpful, really useful.
And
then I just started. But then from there, you know, the character was our character. It wasn't based on one of these women. So we just mm-hmm. sort of, then there was a lot of just, you know, whatever, working on it.
So the decision about where the lines would be was difficult, or was it just kind of, this is the way the story went for you guys as you thought about it and discussed it?
How do you mean?
Just in that, the choice of what part of the story to tell.
Right. Oh, sure.
Not the lead up to the relationship,
right.
not the, you know, after things go bad.
Right.
Well, I think actually the day after we initially talked, we watched Notes on a Scandal,
that's
which
true.
Is about this.
Mm-hmm.
And we knew, obviously, we couldn't make that movie because it had already been made. So, how
and
to
you
go.
Came in, so. That's a very campy movie. I mean, I love the movie, but it's a very camp version of it.
Yeah, it's very different.
Yeah. So how can we make our own version of that? And I think, I mean, obviously it's about a woman on the verge of, or not on the verge, really going mad, but it's about loneliness and desperation and a need to feel close to anyone, someone.
Yeah.
And we were able to take bits of ourselves and put that into.
Yeah. And we were pretty clear that we wanted it to be like a really small, it's a small story, you know, in a way. It's like very focused and small, where where like that movie is much bigger. Yeah. And, but as far as deciding where to start and where to end, I think there was definitely, I know I looked recently back at the very first outline you sent me, and it started way earlier in the story. Mm-hmm. And I think it kind of came to hand, I remember it kind of coming to you like an epiphany, like you were like, I just realized I'm totally going to start it, you know, way in. And I was like, I think that's great. I think that's a great, I thought it was a great idea, because in a way, you kind of know how that goes down, I think.
Yeah. In every single one of the case stories that we read, it was the student was the aggressor and had to be in order for the
teacher
relationship
to
switch.
Yeah.
So.
And also, it's like you want, in a way, yeah, you want to see that because it's sexy or whatever. But that's not really the story that we're actually interested in telling.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, you know.
I was interested in seeing this woman who's so submissive to her own desire that that kind of loss and sadness that happens.
And she didn't really want it to be Will's story. You wanted to keep it on her.
Yeah.
And if he's the seducer, I guess, for the first act, then that moves it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how did you get sucked into this grand seducer?
My agent sent me an email about the audition for it, and it wasn't even like a set date and time. It was just like, hey, here's a script, here's a story. You probably won't want to audition for this, but you know, here it is. Honestly, it's with it because it was a smaller project, you know. And I read the script and I was like, this is fantastic. So I scheduled an audition. I met with Hannah and it was just Hannah and I just talking, you know, we literally just talked, and I think we read some scenes together, and then I left and got called back and auditioned with Lindsay, and it went great.
His audition was great. It was.
And I thought it was, but then I didn't hear back from Hannah for so long, and I was so disappointed because I was like, I didn't get this role. Man, I really wanted that role. It's like a month. Almost. I don't know.
Taking her sweet time.
And she was taking her time.
She already knew.
She drew it out.
She's making you wait.
It's all a psychological game.
She got an email or something.
It's all
a game. But yeah.
Well, Will kissed me in the audition.
Oh, yeah. That was amazing. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
He just went for it. But not even the first time we did this. That was what was funny. It wasn't the first time we did the scene. It was like the second or third time we did the scene. Suddenly, you like went for the kiss, and I was like, That's bold, you know?
Yeah.
I like that you guys blush after almost saying everything.
Yeah.
We're teenagers.
We are.
Well, what really kind of sold the deal on Will was he showed up in a camouflage pickup truck to the audition and like walked up smoking a cigarette and was like, all right.
Yeah. I said after he left, I was like, he smells just like high school.
Like cheap cologne and cigarettes.
Like, yeah.
That's
like,
great.
And like leather
that makes
couches.
My confidence is missing. I don't smoke or wear cologne.
It was perfect, though.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I assume you are actually of age?
Yeah. I was 21 when we shot. I'm 22 now.
You just look youthful.
Yeah.
I guess so, yeah.
It's a good thing.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work in that.
Yeah.
So I was just, you know, worry about watching. You're watching it going, I hope he's not 17.
The
police are going to be here in a few minutes and take over the video.
Right. Yeah.
And as far as the lines of where the relationship were, did you guys discuss, were there things that you wanted to play that you kind of were, let's go in that direction? Because I there's an emotional moment that I see that as an actor is interesting.
No, I mean, Hannah really wrote, I was involved in it in the sense of we talked a lot, but Hannah really like wrote the script and all the emotional beats were there.
Yeah.
And
if scenes weren't working when we were shooting, we luckily had the time to be able to discuss it, and I could spend a few hours rewriting a scene, and then we would be able to shoot it.
Right.
How long did you shoot for?
Like 3.5 weeks, I think, total.
And then I think there was definitely a time when also, Ben, there was like some, once you put it together, the rough cut or whatever, and you saw some places where there you could go further.
Yeah.
Then that's where it sort of maybe went a little bit deeper into things that I was ready to express.
I think like the breakfast scene, I feel like that scene got
at the ranch.
Yeah, at the ranch. Like, you played with that scene a lot.
I don't remember that, but
I just remember us talking about that scene a lot.
Yeah,
but it wasn't like I really need to go crazy right now. Can you just make me able to do that?
Well, I'm sure there were things in this that you were like, you know, chopping at the bit to
totally
get onto the set and do.
Yeah, all of it.
Because it's a full character. It's a
lot of
stuff going on there.
Yeah.
And I did notice in the structure of the movie, even with its limited range, it did seem like, maybe you didn't make the choice, but it seemed like the choice in terms of how you presented the sex was actually broken up into acts, and you progressed as the relationship progressed directorially. Is that fair to say? Is that
that I progressed?
Well, no, that the choice of what you wanted to shoot or how you shot it became more aggressive as you went along.
Sure, yeah.
With the
sex scenes? Oh, yeah, absolutely. And even I think the way that they were having sex was somewhat, it shifted as well.
But I presume in the real life of the movie, behind the what's not on screen, they were having having aggressive sex, and they were first starting out.
Right.
Yeah.
But it's almost like this was a different.
But like a teenage kind,
right.
If that makes sense,
yeah.
As opposed to what it turned it
went
into.
From, yeah.
But it was interesting that you were so patient. I mean, it felt like it was a progression in the story, and not just okay, this scene, you know, let's do the sex scene here, and it's whatever it turns out to be, and then.
Right.
It seems like you were really being careful with it.
Yeah, no,
yeah,
it was really specific.
Important.
Yeah,
it was important to the film.
So, was there anything that made you nervous going into it? Was there anything you were going, I don't know if this is gonna.
The whole thing. The whole movie made me nervous.
Just because of tone, or because of the subject matter, or because.
I mean, you never know if you're going to be able to pull it off, because it's really. It's not just me; it's a whole team of people, and if. You know, one of the links in the fence breaks, then kind of the whole project does. So luckily, I was able to have just talented people who were there to do the best job that they could do, and they did it.
So. And you're relying a ton on Lindsay.
Well, yeah, but I'd worked with Lindsay before, and I knew she was up
completely comfortable that that was the easy part.
Yeah, that I was okay with. I knew that Lindsay was gonna do her job well.
And did you rehearse a lot? Did
no.
you do
no,
just
we
talk
didn't.
Through things? Did
yeah.
they talk through things as actors? Or?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, right.
Yeah, kind of. I mean, we would like.
We talked. We talked.
We didn't really talk about the scenes that much. We would talk within like.
We were more interested context. In like. It was more. We would just would talk in order to form a bond,
right.
So that we could be.
Just
you know?
In between takes, we just.
Yeah.
We're always chatty.
Goofing off.
Yeah.
Chatting.
Yeah.
So you weren't doing traditional
around.
Audition rehearsals.
No.
No. We would do like. We would do like powwows where we would like sit on the bed and be like, okay, so what do we want this to look like? I can remember that happening a lot.
Yeah.
It would normally be, we would talk and then I would go through it afterwards with the director of photography and we would run through after we had discussed.
Yeah, we would talk.
Yeah, and right. blocked it out.
Yeah.
And a lot of takes or? It's long takes?
It depends on the
depends
scene.
On the scene.
Yeah. Long takes, a lot of the film is actually cut down.
So is there a different movie on the cutting room floor, or is it?
No, I think we got the best movie that there is.
And there's not a lot else.
Yeah, that's true.
There weren't a lot of things that were cut, honestly.
Yeah, I don't think we cut any. We cut maybe one or two scenes total.
But emotionally, the scenes, as you redid them, where you were getting the same scenes, you weren't like playing with the layers of content of the story as you were shooting.
No.
So post was not a big issue for you so much? I mean, obviously you have to do it, but.
Post was a lot of fun, mainly because I was able to, so much of the film relies on the score, and I know some people might have a problem with the fact that emotionally the tone of the film can sometimes come across through the score, not maybe through what's on the screen, but to me, that's what I like, so.
So when did you guys see the film for the first time?
I saw a few cuts of it. The first time I saw it, I think I was in LA, and she sent me a link, and I watched it immediately. on my computer with like, and it, the end of the film was very dark. I mean, there's not a lot of light, and it's so light in LA, and so I had to cover myself with a blanket to be able to see the end of the film. And I was just like huddled in my friend's apartment or house, whatever, like this, watching it, like chewing my fingernails. And then I saw a couple more cuts, and I finally saw the last one, and then we saw the premiere last night, which is very exciting.
Yeah.
So was that the first time you saw it? Was last night, or?
It's the first time I saw the final version. Hannah and I watched the version at her office in Austin when she had edited it together, and then
in the spring,
and then I saw another version in the summer when you got in a little bit more, and then I saw a screening in Austin, talkback screening, right before it was colored, and I think sound design.
Yeah.
And then we saw the final version.
And is it intimidating? Are you guys self-conscious watching yourselves perform?
It is the first couple of times for me was like, I was just like, oh, this is so weird. But I really tried at the screening last night to just enjoy the movie and just try not to think that's me or anything, just watch the movie. And I enjoyed it. Yeah, it didn't get in my head last night, which was really nice.
Yeah, I feel similarly. I was, the first couple of times I was watching it for the edit, because I really also like post. And so I was watching it, trying to watch it that way, but it was very hard to separate myself from myself. And but then last night, I also felt, it was kind of surreal, actually.
Yeah.
Because I've been in other screenings of other films, and I really felt like I was kind of watching it for the first time, and I was really able to appreciate what Will was doing, and what Jenny was doing, and what Hannah, all the other elements.
Yeah.
Whereas sometimes when I watch things, I'm like, what am I doing? Why did I do that? You know? And it was really nice to be able to see the whole thing come together in all of the elements last night.
So how do you know where the audience is on a picture like this? When you're sitting in that first screening, do you hear gasping? Do you hear not breathing? I mean, the comedy, it's easy.
There was laughter, but I could feel it.
Like, you could feel the tension in the audience, which I think was good. Like,
yeah.
There's Lindsay's entire family was sitting right in front of
That's
me.
True.
And they were all captivated, of course, but I could just, you know, there wasn't a whole lot of, like, there wasn't a whole lot of moving around, which I think is a good sign, you know, if the audience isn't fidgeting and
stuff.
Yeah,
that is a good sign, I think.
Well, the third act's almost like a horror movie. Don't do it.
Yeah.
You're not going to do it. Don't do that. Yeah. Oh, come on. Don't do that.
And you started seeing people actually lean forward on the other seats, which is nice.
Like, when you pulled up to my house, I heard like a general, like, tone in the crowd of like,
literally just being like, don't.
Yeah, so that was great.
Yeah, and I didn't even realize that it was like that.
No, it's really intense. Yeah,
funny. I was like, well, of course I'm gonna get out of the car and go into his house.
Well, I think everybody had that experience in high school, or you know, on either side of it.
Yeah.
At some point, just being so crazy that you couldn't quite figure out how to restrain yourself.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, that's really what the movie is about. It's not about
having any boundaries.
Yeah. Like, but letting yourself lose it.
Yeah.
And go crazy. And I know a lot of us have that in us, but we don't necessarily go through with it. But I know I, obviously, I've never gone that crazy, but...
Except for that night at the restaurant.
Yeah. Obviously.
You made an entire million out of that.
But I think, you know, it could be cheating on a significant other and letting yourself cross those lines, or...
Any number of things.
Yeah, any number of things.
Well, it's almost more interesting because she's an adult. You know, she's not a teenager, and she's attractive. So I think that maybe that's why people are so obsessed with this particular kind of story in real life is because it's like you see the, you know, the blonde bombshell who's somehow sleeping with her, you know, 14-year-old student, and you're like, why? Why does she have to be doing that? Right.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
What's going on in there? What's percolating?
Right, and it's different. You know, there are a lot of different. All the different women are very different, and the ones who have become like sort of celebrities, I mean, they seem to have this want to be celebrity vibe, which is really strange. I mean, interesting.
Yeah.
But that's not really the kind of woman who we were looking at. I think we wanted to bring it like a little bit closer to, or a little more normal,
like a little more relatable. Even though perhaps for most people she's not that relatable, but.
Well, that's the sequel. It'll be the trial.
Yeah, and she explains herself. When they diagnose her as bipolar, and she's like, I just realized I'm bipolar. That's why I did this.
It's her, Nancy Grace.
In the interview with Matt Lauer.
Yeah. I don't know, Matt Lauer. I don't know what it was.
Okay. But here's my calendar.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Here I am in bathing suits when I'm 18 or
So were there things that were particularly difficult about the experience of shooting this, or did you guys find a place where it was safe and easier?
We had a lot of nice shoots, I think.
Yeah.
And that was hard.
It was tired.
I mean,
it
was there was tough stuff. Me, of course. Everyone worked hard, very hard. But it was fun.
Yeah. I had a blast. Just great energy on set, always. Yeah. Like, no matter where we were, I feel like it was just a great vibe. And it was a lot of fun.
Camera cuts, is it a happy set? Or is it?
I tried to make it a happy set.
It was a happy set,
Lindsay's not so good. Well,
yeah. No, I mean, we're like a family. Like, it's a happy set, like a family.
Yeah.
So you all know a little too much about each other? Is that
well, that's definitely true.
I don't know them near as well as they knew each other. I didn't at the time. And so I was just like, hey, guys.
No, I mean, it was definitely a happy set, but obviously the subject matter is dark. Yeah. So there's a certain, like, you can't call cut and everyone's just like... That would be ridiculous. I mean, maybe they were.
Well, actors who do that, I think, as you know, maybe it's a defense mechanism or maybe it's their way of dealing with it. But there's certainly actors who completely turn off after the most intensive scenes.
No. Sometimes. I mean, sometimes we would do that.
I don't understand how people can do that, personally.
Yeah, well, I don't think.
We would do that during some scenes.
Some scenes, we needed to. But I think on the scenes that we needed to stay focused, we stayed focused.
Like, and everyone on the set was very
respectful. There was just sort of like an unspoken agreement of like, okay, we're going to be
focused. But at the same time, I think. Yeah. I mean, we were all friends, so at times I kind of had to wrangle you to like not have so much fun.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. That's true.
With other cast members.
Yeah. That was one of the fun, like the hard, one of, I was joking, one of the hardest parts was actually like not having fun with Jenny Pritiker, for example, who I had just met and we're now like really good friends. And she's so funny and we'd be doing these scenes and I just wanted to be like, oh, you're great, you're the best. And I was like, no, you're depressed. It's like, oh, I'm sick. But that did happen,
Is it hard to be depressed for that many days in a row?
It was funny because our sound guy, Greg Armstrong, who's this great guy, he was miking me up one day and he was like, do you ever get to be happy in this movie? Yeah, it's hard, but, you know, that's the role. And that, you know, that comes along with all the stuff that was really exciting to play and rewarding to play, so.
So did you time to Sundance, or were you... Is this what you were angling for from the beginning, or?
I think I would have been happy with anything, but obviously this is amazing. I knew I wanted to shoot in February so that I would have a year before the real festival circuit started. Right. But we got lucky that there weren't any major holdups. We could do it in a year. So,
when did you... You submitted in the summer, or
in September.
So that was, and how far was that cut from what you ended up bringing?
It was locked by then.
Oh, so you were good.
Yeah.
So there's no like mad scramble to get your.
No, I think we were one of the few films that had some downtime, which was amazing.
So the downtime is good.
Well, maybe it wasn't. It was, I mean, I know Lindsay and I were nervous wrecks. I don't know if you want me to say that, but.
Yeah, go ahead. You can call me a nervous wreck to anyone you want.
But we spent
a lot of time together.
Just like twiddling our thumbs and eating lunch. Like, we have 1 month left until Sunday.
We're very happy to be here. Yeah. We're very happy that's happening. Because the buildup was a lot.
So this is like the world's longest foreplay.
Yes.
After a while, I get irritated. It's like, you know, okay, I'm chafing. Let's get on with it.
Precisely.
Absolutely.
Just like that. And then you're like depressed. You're like thinking about other stuff.
And do you feel like the bells of the ball? I mean, the whole the number of women in competition is actually a big issue this year.
Yeah, it's
very
amazing.
Excited about it.
Yeah.
Is that are you full feminist in this regard?
Very much so. I think it's fantastic, and I sadly I've been so kind of locked in a vacuum of this film so far that I haven't been able to see any of the other films or really meet too many of the other filmmakers. So
you will Toronto next
year. There's more time. We're going to be here all week also. So.
Yeah.
So. We're going to get to see movies and do stuff. I'm really excited about the women. I think
yeah.
It's awesome.
Yeah, absolutely.
Have you ever felt any kind of restriction on yourself, the idea of being a female director? Is that?
No, I think a male director wouldn't have been able to pull off a film like this. So I feel like I'm able to go to places and film that perhaps weren't able to have been explored before.
But I mean, do you ever feel like, oh, I'm a, was anybody ever said you're a girl, you can't direct?
No.
I mean, is that, have you ever felt that kind of pressure?
No. No.
That's just stupid, too. I mean,
I agree.
For me,
the face of it, it is.
Yeah, for me, because I mean,
the whole industry built
the best
it.
Directors I've ever had in my life from start of theater until now have been female directors, hands down, every single time. Not saying I haven't had good male directors. I've had great male directors, but one of the things when I first auditioned that, like, I took away from that audition, I went and told my, you know, my girlfriend and everyone, I was like, she's like, I want to do this film because of this director, because she was an awesome director. Like, she spoke to me like a director speaks to an actor. So that was like, yes, like that was a major thing. Like, really wanted to do the role because of that.
Female siblings?
Yeah.
And how did your girlfriend feel about the movie?
Oh, she was, I mean, she, you know, she obviously
she,
did not
she,
like
she, it.
She super, jeez, guys, come on, you're making it worse. My girlfriend.
Yes.
She's a very nice young lady.
Very nice young lady, and she is really happy for me, and it was tough for her while we were filming it, but mm-hmm. she was very respectful of the art and understands that I'm an actor, and she gets it, you know, she's cool about it. So yeah,
sweet.
Lots of flowers going on during that, and hugs and kisses.
What's a weird thing? Because in theory, you have nothing to apologize for. You know, you're doing your job, and she knows what your job is.
Exactly. So it's still awkward, though. I mean, I wouldn't want to see her kissing some guy on screen. Like, geez.
Yeah, and to a certain extent, I mean, you don't have to, but I know the way that you work and the way that I work, like. You kind of close yourself off to what's going on in the rest of your life while you're doing a movie that's this close.
Yeah, and it's hard on the people.
It's hard on the people
to.
You're close to.
It is.
Very hard.
And have you shown it to the boy from the restaurant yet? Or
I never even talked to him.
No. What a shame.
Every boy in Austin is going to think it's him.
That could be like a competition.
Maybe you went to the Galaxy Cafe.
It's that right time. No, that's kind of a great promotional idea.
It's a good idea, yeah.
Find the boy in the galaxy who fits the movie.
And is that's it all, our next movie.
And you're all caught up in the Sundance snowball at this point? It's kind of like you're just waiting for a little breathing room from publicity and all of that to enjoy something else?
I mean, this is pretty enjoyable.
It's pretty awesome.
It's wild.
I'm enjoying the snowball.
It's really wild.
Yeah.
It's kind of a nice thing.
Yeah.
It's
cool.
And are you feeling like the bell of Sundance these days, or
the bell of Sundance?
You didn't stop in the streets yet?
Yes.
For the first time yesterday, stopped me on the street
and on the shuttle.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I forgot that.
And in the grocery store.
And in your bedroom.
You're a knock at the window. I'm recreating the movie.
No, I mean, it's kind of cool because this is kind of neat, I think, that like the poster for the movie is the back of my head. Mm-hmm. So I feel like people really have to have seen the movie, actually, to know that I was in the movie, which is nice.
Yeah.
It's like a little secret, like, you know.
Well, it's also a very smart one sheet, just because where it sets you up for the movie is, you know, it's just... You kind of put you in the right frame of mind, I think, for it.
Yeah.
It's certainly not exploitative.
Good.
Like so many good things. And so you'll be playing a nun in the next movie?
A nun? I hope so.
Good Disney film.
I thought that was serious. What?
I've wanted to play. I have, actually, really. I threatened to join a convent last year.
Threatened to?
To who? I don't know. I was just, well, you know, thinking that was a good idea. And Ty West was like, no. but the next movie I'm playing a woman whose mother has dementia, and it's like a little bit of a haunted-y movie, so it's
also set in Austin.
Also in Austin, also female filmmaker, so that'll be fun.
You're just remaking a teacher?
No, it's not teacher again.
You're
it's a different movie.
Again, though, right?
I might have to be a little down. One of these days someone's gonna be like, you're happily married, you have a baby, you're just you're in the woods, you're running around,
you're gonna be like,
flowers falling out of the sky. I'll be like, okay.
A lot of jokes.
So many jokes.
When they ask you to do that, you'll be like, oh, my career is over.
Yes.
It's all over now. I'm playing mommies and, you know, going to daycare. It's not really what I'm. Now, the naked mommy seduces the daycare.
There we go. Now you're talking.
The entire daycare.
The entire daycare.
That's right.
Every child in the daycare.
What?
That's what he was saying.
Right.